Good afternoon. It's a real pleasure being back home in Germany. I've been asked to tell you a bit about the history and the future of the self-driving car. It was great this morning if you went to the opening event to see my successor, the incredible John Krawczyk, on stage telling you about Waymo and its impact on the world. That team was started by me and my colleagues. There's no presentation in Germany would be complete about self-driving car without mentioning 83-year-old Ernst Dickmanns, who in the 1980s, with Mercedes-Benz and the University of the Bundeswehr, started the field. Long time ago, when I was an undergrad. In the 90s, activities moved to the United States. Dean Pomelo invented neural networks for self-driving in the landmark PhD thesis. And I, being a little bit younger, got into self-driving cars around 2004. I started when the US government initiated a race called DARPA Grand Challenge. DARPA is the Department of Defense's agency for advanced research. It invented the internet and stealth bombers. And in 2004, they were fed up with robotics so badly that they gave a prize money of $1 million for someone who could build a self-driving car. 2005, I started my own team. This is Stanley the robot, a Volkswagen. We did this together with Volkswagen. This robot is now in the Air and Space Museum in Washington, D.C. And to say it was easy would be a lie. This is my beginnings. This is how the world looked like for us. And we programmed machines to drive themselves. Lucky to us, our competitors encountered the exact same problems. Batteries. That was the state of the art in 2005. And come October 2005, the US government reissued its race, and you would have been impressed how stupid cars can be when they drive themselves. These are the preliminary trials. Various teams, 23 in total, try to compete for a starting at their pole position, including UC Berkeley's motorcycle. So in 2005, the IAA was justified not to talk about self-driving cars. It just didn't work. Now, we had a car, Stanley, and my Stanford students had programmed it, and it actually made it into the race. This is another one of these. So the race itself was fun. Can we take down the volume, please? Thank you. This is Stanley, a modified Volkswagen Touareg. Touaregs had just appeared on the planet that same year. You see there's no vehicle inside, and it had to drive 131 miles on its own. Its second pole position, somewhere in the race, it passed the front runner, Carnegie Mellon. This is video footage taken from its cameras, and it had to move into a mountainous, treacherous desert pass to make life or death decisions. After almost 7 hours, it was able to recover from this desert track and reemerge at the starting position. And it was the first robot ever to finish a DARPA Grand Challenge. And to us, it was magic. It looked like nothing, but the fact we were able to program a robot that could go on its own without a driver inside for almost 7 hours was transformative. And that was the moment when I realized there's going to be a different future. There's going to be a future where cars drive themselves. And I was probably the only one thinking about this because most of us hadn't seen the technology yet. And those who saw it realized that an empty desert is not nowhere as complex as driving 250 kilometers per hour around Frankfurt. The one person who believed in me was Larry Page. Larry Page had funded a search engine company called Google. And he came to the race. And he challenged me and said, Sebastian, can you build a car that can drive on any street in the world, no matter where it is? So we started at Google, scoping out what would be the hardest to drive streets in California that you can possibly find. And this is an example of a road. In fact, some of this footage from that specific drive was shown this morning in John Krafcik's video. A road that goes through the mountains, through the coast road, all the way to San Francisco, down Lombard Street and up Market Street. And that looked really hard. So I built a small team at Google that's now known as Waymo. And we built these cars that early on were able to drive completely secretly on public roads in California. This is an example of a Prius, or a very first generation car. You see it here driving through Palo Alto. The people around it have no clue they're part of an experiment. And it moves on. So by 2010-ish, we are able to drive pretty much any road in San Francisco. This is video footage in San Francisco. You can see all kinds of funny obstacles, stop signs, highway roads. And while this car was not robust enough to really take the driver off the car, it was the very first proof that in principle, it was possible to build a self-driving car. And that, to me, is the true birth moment of the self-driving car. You might remember this from the morning's presentation. Here you see Dion in the headlights. This car was able to negotiate an incredible variety of different terrain, including crooked Lombard Street, which is probably the hardest street to drive in San Francisco. Driven inside the car is exactly the same technology that the Waymo car uses today. Today is much more sophisticated, of course, but it uses a laser camera that's able to understand how far things are away. It uses a visual camera, uses radar, it uses sonar, and it's able to visualize what's happening, understand what's happening, and then make predictions. And when you make predictions, you can understand how you can best interact and drive safely. Today, the car has driven nearly 10 million miles by itself, completely safely. It's kind of an accomplishment. In more recent years, I'd say the most important technological innovation in this field has been machine learning. Deep learning, machine learning are synonymous. These are technologies where you can train computers on examples. Machine learning saw its birthplace in the 50s. You saw it being leveraged into games in the 90s. You saw it more recently used for skin cancer diagnostics or legal document discovery. And it's also massively been used for self-driving cars. Machine learning is a way to train computers, allow computers to find their own rules, and it uses mathematics. It's very similar to the way all your brains function. In fact, the technology underneath is often called neural networks. With deep learning, it's actually quite easy to build systems that can, for example, segment computer images to find roads. This is work done by students, turns out, by students of my company Udacity that take our courses. They build projects like these, where they find road imagery using deep learning, machine learning. And then there's examples where these students even find really hard road imagery. This is an example of machine learning applied to camera images on a surface street. And what's remarkable about that is, it's incredibly hard even for us people to say where the road is. And these neural networks, after a few hours of training, are capable of just finding the road surface. So take a look at this one. So that's an example of today's technology. The field of machine learning is massively changing everything, including the way we build self-driving cars. Students of this company, Udacity, put together software and built a self-driving car that could drive itself on camera only. It's a big debate whether you need lasers. The answer is we don't. If your system is smart enough, you can drive on vision only. And this is an accelerated run on an El Camino Real, which is a surface street in Silicon Valley, all the way from Mountain View to San Francisco. Completely hands-off autonomous. And these technologies are now being leveraged. You've heard this morning about Waymo. This is a competing company, spin-out from Udacity called Voyage, where self-driving cars today are being used to help aging people in a retirement community to get around. Every day. There's a community called The Villages in Florida, where if you are old enough, you can enter a self-driving car, and you're being driven around today. This technology is ready today, it's safe, it's working. Now, you might say, that's great, Sebastian, why you stop working at Waymo? And the answer is, well, I actually believe in a few years' time, the hottest topic here at IAA will not be self-driving cars, will not be electric cars. It'll be flying cars. Okay? Now that sounds crazy, but watch my word, okay? And remember this moment. Now, flying cars are funny. Flying cars aren't really cars. The technology is now being built by German companies like Lilium and Volocopter, and by us, Kitty Hawk in the United States. They aren't cars. They are more like planes or drones or helicopters. But the vision is you can transform all of urban mobility when you go up in the air. So we've built vehicles like those. These are vehicles that are electrically powered, that take off and land vertically like a helicopter, that fly like a plane with a range of 100 or more miles, and you can't hear, they're super quiet. This vehicle is called Cora, which we're building jointly with Boeing. This vehicle is called Flyer. It's a smaller drone. And here's a video of how this looks like in practice. These are electrically powered vehicles that take off and land vertically, that don't require pilot experience. You can fly safely over ranges of up to 100 miles or 170 kilometers. So watch my word, IAA. 10 years ago when I told people the future is self-driving cars, everyone smiled at me and none of you would have taken me seriously. I'm sure none of you takes me seriously right now, but watch my words. Once we go in the air, urban mobility will be transformed. And how much? Well, this is obviously Frankfurt, where we are. We have technology today. We can get you from the airport to downtown in 3 minutes on 1 cent of energy. We have technology today, if you're from Munich, that gets you from Munich airport to downtown Munich in 6 minutes on 3 cents of energy. This is something I can demonstrate to you today. I'm not making this up. And just imagine how transformative it will be. When you look at Bay Area traffic, where I'm from, on the left side, you find typical statistics. The average commuter speed is about 18 miles per hour. Every commuter distance is about 16 miles. That's true for the Bay Area. And people spend roughly 50 minutes per day commuting in cars. These numbers you can get off the web. They are well documented. That means per year, you spend about 1,800 whatever hours in commute, and per day you pay for your energy, commute energy, about 63 cents. Okay, it's just the way it is. Your car will cost you per mile roughly 50 cents. Your government reimbursement rate is about 60 cents, and Uber is about $1.15, $1.20. I believe with this technology called eVTOL for electrical vertical takeoff and landing. At scale, we can go easily 170 miles per hour. Our commute distance will shrink because we're going in a straight line to 14 miles, which means your 54-minute commute will go down to 5 minutes. Okay? And that's going to happen. It's going to happen to all of you. Okay? That means you're going to spend much less time in a car, or you can live much further away, or both. Okay? So your 1,800 commute hours will shrink to 170 hours. Your energy cost per day will shrink to 21 cents, and your cost per mile will drop significantly below car ownership. And when that happens, when cars become dirt cheap, when travel becomes dirt cheap and super fast and super safe, it'll transform all of transportation, okay? You have a chance to ask questions using Slider. You have a chance to disapprove in Slider. And I'm looking forward to the debate in a few minutes. But I want to thank you for your presence at this presentation. I'm looking forward to talking to you some more. Thank you.